guys, it's Lauren Yeates from Rave It Up here, and I'm privileged today to be with Brooke Satchwell. Hey Brooke, how are you going
Oh,
today?
And I am privileged to be with Lauren Yeates, media mogul in the making.
Thank you. That's so nice of you to say. Welcome to Rave It Up.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you on the show.
Lovely to be here.
And since it is your first time on the show, we'd love to get
Does
to know you.
Does that mean we haven't even started yet, but I've got the potential to come back?
Absolutely. If you want to come back.
Smiley thing. It's great.
You're always welcome to come back. Okay. If you want to come back.
You might not say that at the end of this, but let's see what happens.
We'll see what happens. But since it is your first time on the show, we'd love to get to know you a little bit better.
Okay.
And I think we should start from the beginning because that only makes sense too, right?
Sure. Okay.
Now, you were raised on a small farm, is that correct?
Yes, and a small farm.
Mm-hmm. And discovered by a casting agent when you were working in your mum's shop one day. Is that right?
Almost. So, yes, the small farm was a one-acre block in the middle of thousands of hectares of cattle land. Spectacular one-acre block, fruit trees across the back, chooks, horses, the whole thing.
Everything.
Loved it. Learned to garden at a very young age. So happy. And I was at home. No, well, not at home. At my mum's. She had a children's clothing business at the time in an industrial estate. And I had a cat scratch down my face and gastro.
And lovely day.
That was the budding of my career.
On that day?
Yeah, go figure.
That is weird.
Yeah.
But it was meant to be.
It's just how it is.
Did you ever think of becoming an actor before then? Or
I was a bit more of a behind-the-scenes kind of girl. I used to put on Christmas productions many productions and kind of have these extraordinary photo shoots and kind of make installations. And I'd quite often be, like, dressing up my cousins and my sister and putting them in pot plants and doing all these things. Like, I liked that side. And I will get back there. That's kind of my roots.
Oh, cool. Mm. And is it true that you wanted to become a forensic psychologist?
I was really fascinated by it. Yeah, actually, that was the thing. So I sort of got to year 9 and 10 and, career education, what do you want to be when you grow up? I had no idea.
It's so daunting, isn't it? It's
you've got to choose it right now. I don't even understand what my options are. I don't. And so that was sort of, career education time. I mean, now in retrospect, I'd love to be a meteorologist, as we were discussing earlier, with the good T-shirt game that's happening behind the camera over there. I love storms and weather phenomenon. And also, as we were discussing, the superstell that is coming tonight. Oh. Very exciting.
Just get out of Sydney, everybody.
So that's something I was interested in. And, forensic photography, I think, was or forensic psychology. They were the two things I was kind of looking at that point in time.
We're learning a lot about you already.
Yeah.
All the starting points, Brooke. And was it true that you also worked in a morgue before becoming an actress?
No, that's what happens with the internet.
Yes.
I'm also a pilot. Yeah, I am. The truth to that is because I was working 80-hour work weeks as a 15, 16-year-old and I didn't get school holidays, my friends would go away with their families and I'd have no one to play with. So my mum was like, well, you're earning a pretty good wage for a 15-year-old. Why don't you get your pilot's license? There was an airfield around the corner from where we were. It was something I'd been, again, interested in, and I did a few, and then just life happens, and it's kind of one of those things, I wish I'd followed it through at that point in time, because I think it's a bit trickier to kind of, and more expensive to pursue that now, but one day, you always have a few projects that'll find their completion at some stage, never say never.
Something that you cross off the bucket list.
Yeah, totally, but no, as for the morgue, that came about because in relation to Career Education Week, they took us on excursions, the boxes we'd ticked, career number 502 that, I'm interested in. They did a tour of the morgues and I was there, but then when they went into the freezers, I actually had to go to my Neighbours audition. So I actually missed going in there, and I told that story, and then I worked in a morgue.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Automatically worked in the morgue when you're just visiting.
Yeah.
Is it as creepy as it sounds in there?
Well, I guess I didn't get to see it. It's one of those things. It's on the bucket list.
Watch to become a mortician.
Yeah. I'll get there one day.
Maybe.
Literally.
I don't know if you. Oh God. I get it. You probably won't be able to see it yourself, but you'll be there.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
Aspirations.
Mm-hmm. So after a series of ads, you were like a hand and foot model at the beginning.
Again, internet. Thank you.
Thank you, internet.
Essentially my foot featured in a Clark's school shoe commercial. And
that's
Yeah. And only my
That's
hand was seen
you,
in a Just
it?
Jeans commercial. So, yeah.
But then you did a series of ads, and then you went to do the audition for Neighbours.
Yeah,
and
I did.
Got that.
Well, I did two auditions. So I'd after the cat scratch gastro incident, fateful meeting. The lady was from a casting agency, and she just happened to also sell children's books door to door at that point in time in her life, and hence our paths crossed. And she gave us a card. We said, yes, okay. Now, technically, a casting agent wouldn't represent you, but for some reason, they were lovely to me, and they would call me in for these castings, and I got commercials.
They saw the cat scratch.
Very deep. And then on different jobs that I was doing, the pearls of wisdom from makeup artists and different people, darling, I've got to get an agent, da-da-da-da. I'm like, I'm 14, I don't even know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And yes, I did in the end, and I sat on the books for about a year, nothing. And then one day there was an audition for an ABC job and for Neighbours, and I did the two auditions, and 2 weeks after that I got off the school bus about to go mop floors for $4 an hour at my local milk bar, which I loved. And
changed your life.
Mum handed me a card and a little bracelet and went, you got the job. And 2 weeks later my life was very different.
Oh, that was only like 14, 15 as well. So young.
Yeah, it was 2 weeks before my 16th birthday that I started working.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. And how was your experience on that show? You feel like
absolutely brilliant. You know, it was jumping in. It was a huge thing. And I mean, you're talking about an era that wasn't as kind of, it was a lot more innocent than things are now, and we weren't as media savvy. The internet was still in the throes of being built. It wasn't, you know, just attached to us permanently. It was one of those really, and it's kind of quite beautiful, because at the moment with the play that goes wrong, the job that I'm doing, that it was this really lovely group of people. I was really fortunate to be surrounded by very kind people and very real people, and that's what I've got. It's really nice now, 20 years later, to be able to, it's a rare thing that occurs, you know, any kind of group interaction, you know, there's the odds of that being the case are quite rare sometimes. And I was really fortunate, being so young and sort of so inexperienced, and it not being a world that I had any reference point for. And just, I mean, those people are still my friends today.
Oh, that's lovely.
You know, one of my lovely friends from that job rocked up with a washing basket the other week with like 6 ready-made curry meals and Voltaren and quinine in tonic water, because apparently it's good for bruising, and this job, we'll get to that, but this job causes a few. And you know, just this little care package. And so I was
so
really
beautiful.
Lucky that and it's like, I guess it's like being in school too. It's one of those things, the random kind of grouping that you fall into. I fell into a good year.
And you've all moved on, but you've stayed friends. It's
Great. The integrity of the connection is very real.
It's good to hear that, because in this industry, you know, people get very competitive, and it's like, I want that job, but you just starting out, you've gotten that great support system.
And we were talking earlier, like, I joined Instagram. Well, I didn't join it technically. I did a takeover. 1 week only, kids. Like, that's it. That's all I'm capable of. But that didn't exist. And I have heard that particularly in those kind of environments of the soaps and a lot of the jobs that have a very young core cast, because of this new element that kind of invites, I guess, the scrutiny and that kind of mass audience kind of watching every move, and as it's discussed just in kind of general sort of teen behaviour, or, you know, or everyone's behaviour with social media, that kind of propensity to curate and edit your life to present a version that you think is whatever you want, you know, is more palatable, cooler, sexier, whatever the hell thing it is you're going for.
I'm better than you think I am.
The big edit that we're all doing, which is really, that's no fun.
No.
And that didn't exist when I first started working, and I'm so grateful for that, because I can't imagine. You know, it's tough enough being those ages and kind of stepping out into the world, but to have that layer on top, and particularly for those young kids that are working in jobs like that,
And now you're getting into Instagram.
I've changed.
You're getting into it.
By the end of the day, I'll be a basket case. It's only been 7 hours.
You'll be fine. Who knows?
No.
Since you have this viewpoint on it, you may change the world. One Instagram post
rebel
at a time.
Antisocial rebel without a cause, I think.
We'll see how it goes.
Maybe, yeah. But for the time being, one week only. Although they've created a monster because I think they only gave me the keys to the gram, whatever it's called. at 9 o'clock today. I got locked out. The first thing I posted was actually me Googling how do you post a photo
Instagram?
Yeah. I'm legitimately show you. And we finally solved that. Yeah,
they're going to be funny posts, I think.
Yeah, but then I've actually been like, yep, I'm going to spam you. That's done.
Everyone can
created
follow
a monster.
But with our Neighbours, mm-hmm. what do you think is the number one lesson you learnt during your time on that show?
Do you know, someone actually asked me that today, and I really do. It taught me an incredible sense of professionalism because the workload is immense. I mean, we were shooting 25 minutes of screen time a day. Now, to give you a kind of reference point, you know, film, they can shoot a minute or seconds, as you probably know. Mm. Sorry, we're in the Instagram age. I forget that people know this stuff now. I didn't understand it, for argument's sake, then when I went on to working on Water Rats or White Collar Blue, and we were shooting 12 minutes a day, and, you know, there was all that time sort of lag in between movement. And I would say, and obviously time is money, so generally speaking, people are very conscious of that the whole time, and ADs are kind of tapping their watches. And I remember saying to one of the ADs one day, I was like, what are you waiting for? And I was like legitimately asking the question, having been used to operating at such a pace. And he's like, yeah, thinking I was being ironic. And I was like, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, I'm
serious.
Legitimately asking what we're waiting for. So it, because of the speed and the volume, it really did give me some incredible skills, because it is a bit of a wild industry to be involved in. I mean, even more recently, doing Dirty Laundry and Wonderland, I was doing 40-hour work weeks in Melbourne and 80-hour work weeks in Sydney. And as you can appreciate, that math doesn't work, particularly with an interstate commute in the middle. But I became very efficient at, you know, Sunday nights being my chop the veggies, do the juices, taking care of the health and get everything organised. I was practically like Zen, going through airports with keys already off. Key rings, and everything was just streamlined to go through. And also that ability just to surrender, obviously have the prep work done, but rather than get caught in the fears and the panics, and I think this is something that's come a little bit later, but to be able to just be present and deliver what is required in that moment. And I think the embryonic stages of that were having no acting background and suddenly
straight into it,
being on Ramsey Street going and go, and I think that was the beginning. I think, you know, any level of kind of awareness, control, or ability to take ownership of that to a degree has come a bit later. And I think also the kind of collaborative aspect of a team on set environment. Mm. As I say, because I was lucky to be of a year that was gold, that kind of cohesiveness just was so natural to me. So that's something that I seek to engender in every job that I go into.
Yeah,
and that seems
great.
To work quite well. Yeah.
And your time management must be impeccable now.
Oh no, it's pretty spectacular if I don't say so myself. And I am old school. I have a diary that I don't like to buy ones with the days already planned out, because it's a bit of a mind map, because it's really quite good. Like in cards, and everyone gives you little notes.
I do the same thing.
And so I rule it all up each week, and I actually, at certain points when things are really busy, sounds insane, but I do have my day broken down into 5-minute increments, and it's like brush teeth does sometimes get listed, or, you know, get a
go
banana
to the toilet.
That never seems to make it on the list, and that causes me a lot of grief.
Yeah.
But
good, you're at least reminding yourself, I still got to eat somewhere in there, healthy
some
food.
Major micromanagement. And then, you know, I do have the flip side that, you know, occasionally that just then goes all out the window and it's freestyling. So, But the foundations are there.
You do start getting better at it. I know, like, more I'm getting busier, it's like, okay, I've got to write down everything and figure out how I'm going to fit everything
in. Well, and isn't that amazing? Like, I think it's like anything, the more you kind of grease those wheels, like then when you do get thrown the curveballs and you don't have any choice but to operate in that manner, you lose the fear around not having control over the circumstances.
Yeah.
And yes, you do have this ridiculous list of things that you have to execute in this
short time.
and it really is it's an exercise in letting go of control and trusting that is equally as productive and efficient at times.
Yeah. I feel like it clears your mind too. Yeah. When you have so much in there, it's like, let's just write it all out.
Yeah.
Then I can
and
see
be
it.
Here now. Yeah, totally.
There you go. Some great advice for the listeners out there.
Put it in your diary with credit and rule it out.
Yeah. More.
On blank pages, be here now.
And if you like colours, colour it up.
Well, I always say to people with the whole book thing, it kind of adapts to the user. Like, make it your mind map. It's yours.
Yeah. It's great. There you go.
All right, sister.
We're very similar.
Yeah.
It's great. Now, I hope you don't mind me bringing this up.
By all
and
means.
I know it is quite a touchy subject, mm-hmm. but I think it is
There's
something...
There's any number of things in my life you could be about to reference right now,
yes.
So it's okay. It's okay.
But I think it's something that isn't talked about enough mm-hmm. in this world, so that's why I thought I'd bring it up. You know, that is what Rave It Up is about. Back in 2006, it became known in the media that you were assaulted by your ex, and you were like one of the first people in Australia in... the public eye to really raise awareness of domestic violence. How do you feel about that? Are women still contacting you and going, thank you for coming forward? And
do you know, it's a funny one, that in particularly in the way you just framed it to me, because I'm only just starting, I think, to recognise that is a way that people perceive that moment in time. I think, you know, obviously there are certain reports. I mean, the conversation obviously has progressed significantly since then. But there would be reports. But I guess perhaps in my case, and this is what I think I'm starting to understand, is that whatever it was that whatever I represented to people reflected it back in a way that maybe it was the first time that it wasn't just something they could read as a news story.
Yeah.
Maybe, I don't know. I mean, in fact, I'm only kind of maybe realising that now as I talk to you now. It's an interesting one because I was just kind of living an experience and dealing like I wasn't actually. And I know there was a little bit of a push at the time to kind of be a patron saint of whatever. And that's the true depths of my situation at that time, which, you know, I find interesting I haven't discussed it. A lot of details are readily available, but it's interesting how media really works and how much effort sometimes goes into finding truth.
Yeah.
But that's probably good for me in the long run. But I was more just dealing with the situation, and yes, elements of that, fragments of that, were being reflected back in the media. It has been interesting to see that. I guess in a way that was a catalyst for the conversation becoming much larger. And as you said, only probably in the last maybe 18 months, 2 years, have people started to frame it back to me in the way you just did. And obviously, you know, people like Rosie Batty and Phil Cleary and a lot of people have done some significant work in the meantime and really championed the discussion and also pushed for legislation change and really what I find, I mean, in terms of what you're saying, that was brought up with me again earlier today, and someone said to me, what I found to say is one of the more significant things that I have brought out of the experience is in terms of, you know, if there was anything that may in some way help someone. It was said to me once at that point that one of the most tricky things for, be it a man or a woman in that situation, is the letting go of the picture of what could have been or the perception of what could be. And that's your sort of, that's the prison in your own mind. And it's, I mean, I do think that relates to a lot of things we do to ourselves as human beings. But I guess it's particularly pertinent in that situation because it's one of the first things I think you need to come to terms with or surrender, because particularly, and look, and I do refuse to make it gender specific, because I think anyone who is in a loving relationship and is genuinely trying to build a life with someone, you're wholly invested. That is the world you are creating. That's what we do.
Yeah.
To actually accept that, you know, it's a bit of an illusory notion in that respect. is a really, that's the kind of first brick to take out of the wall to then start having the self-governance and self-possession to take ownership of your life again.
And heal and move on. Yeah. Mm. I appreciate you talking about that. Hopefully it's
obviously a much bigger conversation.
Well.
But
yeah. Maybe for another time.
Yeah, maybe. Well, we said we'd chat again.
Yes. Yeah. If you want to come back on. And I guess to brighten up the mood now, your latest project is The Play That Goes Wrong.
It's Just Damn Silly.
Which
is,
I'm so excited to say. I'm coming with bells on, you betcha.
Oh, well, you did. We were discussing the potentiality of your outfit.
And, yeah, we're like, what do I wear?
Really go, and I think the bells are a good choice.
might as well dress up, you know.
And then when you clap and laugh, we'll be able to hear you, and I go, yeah, Lauren was in on that one. That's good. It's great. Yeah.
What can we expect if we're coming along?
You can expect your stomach muscles to ache.
Okay, so maybe bring tissues because I'll be crying because it's so funny.
Absolutely, make sure you go to the bathroom beforehand. it really is. It's just been such a gift, this job. We just get to make people laugh. We just destroy them with laughter for 2.5 hours.
That is the best medicine.
Exactly, and this is why I really dig it at the moment, because I mean, as I'm sure you're aware, with a lot of the conversations you're having and you know, the perspective you're taking out on the world, we're in a bit of a tipping point at the moment, and we all have a lot of work to do in terms of personal responsibility and global responsibility.
Big time. Yep.
Yeah. And you know, we're all a bit fatigued. Life is, you know, life's life. But the beauty of laughter and the beauty of this job is it's just that complete surrender and release.
You forget shake about everything.
Tension, shake out the cobwebs, feel energized, get back out there and get at it.
And you get to do that as a job.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. I mean, as you can tell, I'm pretty knackered at the moment. Yeah. I can barely speak and my English is my second
language
right now.
You're doing good.
But it's so rewarding. And I just get in the car and no matter how exhausted I am or how many bruises I have that day, I just get really excited to get to work. And it's like, I'm like a little kid. And then we get that response from the audience and it's just solid gold. It's really great. And it is absolute innocent anarchy. Like it's madness and chaos. And, you know, the set is another character. Things explode. Shatter, collapse.
So excited.
Bananas. We basically have like this mixed martial arts fight for like the last 15 minutes of the play. It is so cool. But it's a show that is also incredibly family friendly. Like there's
good.
Nothing that, you know, kids of a theatre going age wouldn't be able to see. So yeah, to be that joyous and that innocent and that silly, that's just great.
So happy. And have you found theatre compared to TV?
Well, I have my two, like I have my favourite things about both. So the thing with TV I love is the, you know, egg and bacon roll at 4 a.m. in some car park in some random place.
Yeah.
You don't know if it's going to rain or be stinking hot and you've got this like group of 50, 60 people and it's like, okay, we have this 12 minutes. You're all across this now, I understand. We have this 12 minutes to shoot today and, you know, you don't know what might be thrown at you in terms of sound issue, whatever it might be, issue that might be in the way. But it's like almost like The Amazing Race in a day.
Yeah.
And it's like, all right, we've got to get this done. And when you do, it's like, yes. and also too, because, you know, TV kind of has that more extended life, the kind of the sustained relationships that you get to develop with people, that kind of collaboration. It's such a transient industry to have that kind of time is great. But then with theatre, again, the immediacy of playing with the electricity of an audience and the kind of abandonment of being able to step out there and it's like you're just stepping off the edge into the darkness. It's like, well, no turning back now. Like, what am I gonna do?
Anybody.
This is great. Yeah. Well, yeah, actually, that's a funny one with this one because my character's a bit of a diva and I spend the whole time like looking up to the stalls and I can't see when I come off stage because I'm staring at the lights.
It's like,
And at certain points, I have to kind of rebuild my face. And I come off and I'm like, I can't. And I've got a very short window of time to get back on stage. So, yeah, if you come on that night, you wouldn't. I've just been blind.
She can't see.
Yeah,
that's why.
Mm.
Well, very excited. Everyone go check it out.
Oh, please come
out. Yeah.
It's on us.
It's on us. And I know that you've already achieved so much in your career, but I think so anyway. What else can we expect from you? What else can we expect from you in the future? What's next after The Play Goes Wrong?
To be honest, I don't know how you feel, but I think 2017 is shaping up to be a spectacular year.
Yes, 2016 was Not
rotten.
Good, I don't think, for anybody.
First rule of 2017. We do not talk about 2016.
I like that
second
rule.
Second rule.
Yep.
no, I'm really inspired for 2017. Some really incredible opportunities have come my way that, I'm going to own it. Like, they're the fruits of 20 years of hard work.
And yeah,
they,
good.
I've had the most amazing things where literally things I could have only dreamed of have just been handed over. And I'm really interested in creating content. I've got some great opportunities in that respect. Writing is something I did prior to acting. And finally, I'm going to find some space to things I've been sitting on for, 16 odd years. Like, the time is ripe. And beautifully, a lot of the content that I'm really interested in looking at, the pertinence and relevance, even though it might have been sitting on the shelf for 16 years, it's almost like the full circle thing.
Yep.
The time is now. So it's very supportive in that sense. And some great people to work with, some people that I really respect and admire, offering opportunities and support. And a bit of diversity. It's really cool.
It's kind of like what we said before, crossing things off your bucket list, doing them. Oh, totally. Good. Well, we're looking forward to your future projects. Okay. We'll look out for them. Come back on the show.
A new bucket list at the end of the year.
Yes.
Maybe that's what we can come back and talk about.
The new bucket list. How 2018 is going to be.
Yeah.
Hopefully it'll come on before that.
Now? Three. Okay.
Yeah, three months into the year. Yeah. Hopefully before 2018.
Yeah, we will. Good. I think we've got a timeline now, so it's time to achieve.
Let's do it.
And then
yeah.
we'll come back for the next one.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I just scared you then, didn't I?
The year's going so quickly already.
And I also lost my language again. You're just like, oh my God, we need to end this now.
This is what's making such a great interview. And what advice would you give to the listeners who might want to become an actor as well? Follow their dreams.
Bring your Tupperware.
Bring it up,
because catering is the bomb, and waste not, want not, and it saves you from having to cook. And let's face it, you're not going to earn that much money.
I thought you were just going to be like, if you want to live healthy, make your own lunch and dinner.
Well, that
but
too.
No,
preparation
steal the food.
Is key. what advice? Look, I think this is a very non-linear industry, and I think take your inspiration from whatever place feels, whatever place resonates with you.
Take it from
verbal, non-verbal, a human, a piece of art, whatever it is, and just string all those little pearls together and make it yours. That's the only way it can really work. There is no true path. There is no right way.
Yeah.
It doesn't work that way. Neither does life.
Yeah,
exactly. So forget that. Don't get caught up in that, because that's just going to keep you doing donuts for an awfully long time and waste an awful lot
that's
of time
and energy.
That's
a good metaphor, actually. Just act like it's life.
Yeah.
Doesn't really have a
path. Well, essentially, that's what it is. I mean, that's why those of us in this field, we dig it.
Everyone has a different answer about how they got started.
Yeah.
So,
and that was
true
the one,
example.
Going back to one of your earlier questions, that was one of the things that was really precious about the time on Neighbours. As a 15-year-old, I got to learn that by working with such a diverse age group across all the different elements of film and television production. And again, everybody having come from a completely different path and getting a kind of insight into that early on, as much as I might not have fully understood it or appreciated that, getting that kind of foundation to then kind of grow my way through
you get it
was
now.
Really cool. Yeah.
Yeah. See, everyone has their own story.
Yeah. But the Tupperware is crucial.
The Tupperware. Get some Tupperware.
Yeah.
Now. That's something you can do right now.
Yeah.
Take it from Brooke.
BPA free, please.
Yeah. Now, we are getting to the end of the interview, unfortunately.
Yes.
It's been a lot of fun. It's gone really quickly.
It's been wild.
But as a closing statement, and was probably the most important question, a bit more serious now, knowing what you know now.
I scared her before. Now she's scaring me.
Good. No. No.
That was serious.
Yeah. Good. I'm glad I scared you. Anyway, knowing what you know now, what would you tell your 14-year-old self? Which would have just been starting on Neighbours, I just realised, or auditioning.
Yeah. There is one thing that I think about in relation to this kind of question that you kind of ask yourself, and inevitably people ask you in interviews.
Not
so succinctly and threateningly.
I apologise.
No, but I think, and this is something I sort of, someone asked me something about a year ago, on a red carpet or something, and, advice for 2017, and I stand by it, and I guess it's something. But be brave. Is the thing. Be brave.
That's deep.
It's a really simple and really tricky thing. Because, like I said, I probably thought I was being incredibly brave at that point in time. And sure, for a 15-year-old who had been working in milk bar mopping floors and suddenly was, on national television.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure I was. But I think you can always be braver, and that's something that, you know, you're only going to regret opportunities that you didn't take because you were fearful. And, you know, yeah, you might crash and land on your face and you might do some terrible things, but then you just get up and be even braver.
Yeah.
And that's, I think that's the best advice I can give.
Oh, good. That's good advice for all the young people listening too.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming on the
My
show
pleasure,
today, Brooke.
Lauren.
It's been so much fun.
Awesome talking to you.
And definitely come back. We'll stay in contact.
Good
and make
job
it
too. Nice so, work.
Yeah. Guy behind the camera, good job.
Awesome.
In training.
L plates.
But for everyone watching, make sure to check out Brooke in Play That Goes Wrong, which is at Rosalind Packer Theatre in
Correct.
Sydney. And then it will be travelling to Canberra, Brisbane and Perth.
Correct.
So we'll be here till the 23rd of April. So go check it out. But for now, thanks for watching and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.